Okay, we covered a long overview of the PPF in the last video segment, and now let me go into some of the mechanics and some of the ways in which we can work with and change this thing around. So remember in our example, we have 180 hours available, and we can use those. Either 10 hours gets us one shirt, or we can choose to spend our time here. And notice the way in which we do think about time as a kind of currency. We talk about spending time. 30 hours equals one dress. And we've drawn out the PPF here. And we can think about putting all of our time into shirts, in which case we get 18 shirts and zero dresses. Or we can take all of our time and put it into dresses, in which case we get 180 divided by 30 equals 6 dresses, but 0 shirts. Or any combination of those two, split it 50-50 and so on. So, one thing to notice is we now have some information that allows us to compute the opportunity cost of a shirt or a dress. So, in particular here, notice that every time we produce a dress, we have to take 30 hours. We could have produced 3 shirts in that 30 hours. So, we can say the opportunity cost of one dress equals 3 shirts. So, we have two different ways of thinking about what the cost of a dress is. We can think about the input cost of a dress being 30 hours, or we can think about the cost of a dress being the alternative goods we could have gotten with those 30 hours. And generally, economists favor this as the most relevant way to think about the costs, because time is valuable precisely because you could have been doing something else with it. Exactly how valuable your time is depends upon what else you could have been doing with that time. Okay, we could also say here, notice the opportunity cost of one shirt is one third of a dress. And notice these two are reciprocals. And that's the way it's always going to be in these examples here. So if you figure out the opportunity cost of one good in terms of the other, you can turn that on its head, make the reciprocal, and get the opportunity cost of the other. If we look at the PPF, what we're going to notice here is that this thing has slope negative one-third. And so the slope of the PPF is the opportunity cost of the y good, so the good on the y-axis. I'm sorry, it's the opportunity cost of the x good in terms of the y good. So the slope of the PPF tells us about the opportunity cost of the different goods. So slope of PPF tells us opportunity cost of the goods. In this numerical example I've been doing so far, the trade-offs always remain the same. And we'll come to more complex examples later. The distance the line is away from this origin, away from 0, 0, tells us something about the overall level of productivity, either because of changes in the productivity per input or because of changes in the amount of the inputs. So, for example, notice there are two different ways. let's call this guy PPF1. There's two different ways to get out to a PPF 30, 33, 36. There's two different ways to get out to a PPF that would be out here. Call that PPF 2. One way would be if we had 360 hours available. If we had 360 hours available and these same labor productivity numbers, then we could attain that PPF. A second way would be if we had 180 hours available still, but our labor productivity doubled. If we had 5 hours per shirt and 15 hours per dress. So, and it's kind of obvious to say it, but there's two different ways to increase productivity, or increase total production, excuse me. We can either work more, or we can work smarter and more efficiently. So either of those ways will lead the PPF to shift out. Or put differently, either a growth in an economy's productive inputs, land, labor, capital, that sort of thing, or a growth in technology can lead the PPF to shift out. What if technology improved in one good but not another? So suppose we have our old situation of 180 hours and 10 labor hours equals one shirt. And then we get some sort of new machine or new technique that increases our productivity in dressmaking but not in shirt making. Suppose we have 20 hours now equals one dress as opposed to the old 30 hours. Well, remember, we used to have a PPF, and I'm drawing roughly now. We used to have a PPF that had endpoints that were 6 and 18 because we could produce 6 dresses because we used to need 30 hours per dress. 180 divided by 30 gets us to 6. Now, what's the maximum number of dresses that we can make? The maximum number of dresses we can make has grown to 9. Because we have 108 divided by 20. Has the maximum number of shirts that we can make changed? And it hasn't, because it still takes 10 hours per shirt. So if we have technology only affecting one of the two goods, then the PPF is going to shift in a non-parallel manner. And this is what's known as biased technological growth. And notice, this biased technological growth changes the opportunity cost of the two different goods because it changes the slope. Or, put differently, it changes the ratio here between these two different numbers. We used to have the opportunity cost of one shirt, of one dress was 3 shirts. Now the opportunity cost of one dress is 2 shirts. So the opportunity cost of dresses has fallen. We could equivalently say the opportunity cost of one shirt is now 1/2 of a dress. So the opportunity cost of dresses has gone down from 3 to 2. The opportunity cost of shirts has gone up from 1/3 to 1/2. 1/2 is greater than 1/3. It's a little tricky sometimes to compare fractions. So here we went from 2 to 3. So although the time cost of shirts hasn't changed. Shirts now look more expensive in terms of the output that we have to give up to get those shirts. And that's why economists favor looking at opportunity costs, because they give us the most relevant comparison. The most relevant thing to know in this example isn't exactly the time cost of the shirt, but rather how much I'm giving up in terms of dresses. So biased technological growth changes the relative costs. And all else equal, that would tend to make us want to have more or produce more of the thing that is now comparatively cheaper. So if before we wanted to be at this situation here where we had, say, 12 shirts, and if we had 12 shirts, we would have had two dresses under the old system where this took 120 of our labor hours, and it used to be that this was 30 hours per dress, so we had 60 hours left, excuse me, and so that enabled us to produce two dresses left with our 60 hours left. We will probably want to trade off some of our shirts for more dresses. We don't have to, but it's likely that people are going to want to choose a point like this, because now dresses have become comparatively cheaper.